Hello, my name is Early Ringgold Johnson, and I want to thank you for joining us at Washington College's Evening of Words and Song. Our program is being brought to you by the Starr Center and Chesapeake Heartland. I'd like to take just a few minutes to acquaint our entire audience with the relationship between the Starr Center and Chesapeake Heartland. I get quite a few questions about this relationship, but both of us are part of Washington College. Chesapeake Heartland is part of the Starr Center. So a little bit more information. The Starr Center is the center study for the American experience, where we study our past within our diverse and complex society's issues. Chesapeake Heartland is part of the Starr Center, is an African-American humanities project whose purpose is to preserve and digitize African-American history. We are collaborating with Washington College, the Smithsonian Institute's National Museum of African-American History and Culture. Our main local partners include Sumner Hall, the Kent Cultural Alliance, and Kent County's Department of Libraries, and we have numerous other community organizations as partners. As we study African Americans' history and the great achievements the Black race have made to the entire American culture, we realize that Black history is being expanded from 1 month of February to the entire 12 months in the entire year. Tara Gladden and Jason Patterson were awarded a Chesapeake Heartland Fellowship, and they have presented a series of conversations, and they have been titled Community Campus Conversations. I'll turn this portion of the program over to Tara to explain more about tonight's program. Thank you.
Thank you, Early, and good evening, everyone. As Early said, my name is Tara Gladden, and I am the director and the curator for the Cole Gallery and a proud Chesapeake Heartland staff faculty fellow working in partnership with the wonderful artist, Jason Patterson, whose phenomenal exhibit on the Black history of Kent County and Washington College is currently featured and can be viewed on the Chesapeake Heartland website. And I'll be putting that info in the chat in just a moment. It is a pleasure to be here tonight to introduce this wonderful event. Tonight's program, An Evening of Words and Song, is the third and last in the public community conversation series that Jason and I have worked on in conjunction with his exhibit during the course of our Chesapeake Heartland Fellowship. For this last conversation, we wanted to explore the idea of artistic conversation and decided to take a creative approach. With the help of Early Johnson and Patrick Nugent, the deputy director of the Starr Center, we reached out to those that are featured on the program tonight and invited them to offer a performance in response to the exhibit. What we share with you this evening is a program of original poetry and poignant songs performed by some of the area's most esteemed poets and performers, accompanied by brief interludes offered by Jason that highlight works in the exhibit. A particularly exciting element of this program is its profound intergenerational mix of artists that come together from both the local community and the college community, a wonderful tribute to both the exhibit and the mission of the Chesapeake Heartland Project. No event such as this one would be complete without the most masterful of MCs, so we invited Yvette Hynson, published author, singer, photographer, Washington College alum, board member and treasurer of Sumner Hall, and host of the radio show, The Sunday Jazz Experience, which airs every Sunday from 6 to 8 p.m. on WKHS 90.5 FM, to guide us through tonight's program with her own fabulous style of finesse. So without any further ado, I hand this evening's program over to Yvette.
Thank you, Tara. And welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to an evening of words and songs. Let's introduce our first performer this evening. Our first performer is none other than Karen Somerville. She is an award-winning recording artist, producer, and leader of the a cappella trio Sambarkin. In addition to her music celebrity, she is renowned for establishing the African American Schoolhouse Museum. Having recently received a grant from the Hedgelawn Foundation, Karen is currently producing an album entitled Up and Over, projected for release this spring. Tonight, Karen performs Lift Every Voice and Sing, known as a Black national anthem. This song was initially written as a poem in 1900 by James Weldon Johnson. A year later, his brother, John Rosamond Johnson, composed the music. Congressman James Clyburn has recently sponsored a bill to make the song the new national anthem of the United States. Karen Somerville.
Lift every voice and sing till earth and heaven ring, ring with the harmonies of liberty. Let our rejoice. The faith that the dark past has taught us. Sing a song full of the faith that the present has brought us. Facing the rising sun to a new day begun. Let us march on till victory is won. Stony the road we trod, bitter the chastening. Felt in the days when hope unborn had died, yet with a steady beat have not our weary feet come to the place for which our fathers sighed. We have come over a way that with tears has been watered. We have come treading our path through the blood of the slaughtered, out from the gloomy past. Now do we stand at last where the white gleam of our bright star is God of our weary years, God of our silent tears, thou who hast brought us thus far on the way, thou who hast by thy might led us into the light. stray from the places, our God, where we met thee. Lest our hearts, drunk from the wine of the world, we forget thee. Shadowed beneath thy hand, may we forever stand true to our God, true to our native land.
Well, that was really wonderful. Thank you, Karen. And I'm excited to listen to the rest of the song, or the other song that Karen will be performing for us. So as Tara mentioned, I'm Jason Patterson, and the show here at Cole Gallery is my artwork that I worked put together over the past almost, well, I guess I started it almost 3 years ago, but it was about 2 years of artwork that I worked, that's on the history of Kent County and Washington College, specifically the Black history. So today I'm going to talk about three of the pieces in the show, but you can go online to the Chesapeake Heartland website and see all of the show and see all the text information that goes with every piece that I wrote with my writing partner, Jalen Mone. So the first piece I'm going to talk about today is this piece about Henry Highland Garnett. If you live in Chestertown or go to Washington College, you probably know who Henry Highland Garnett is. He is the namesake of the grade school here, which used to be the segregated African-American school in Chestertown. Garnett was born in Kent County, but was mostly raised in New York and became a prominent abolitionist. And what set him apart in the 19th century as an abolitionist before the Civil War was that he believed in militant abolition, where he believed that African-Americans should fight for their freedom if slavery isn't ended. So the sort of motifs and part things that are going on with this piece, I'll talk about a little bit, is we have Black-Eyed Susans and we have the Liberian flag. The reason why I have these two things is because I want to sort of represent Garnett's life and then his death and sort of where he was in those places. So as many of you may know, Garnett was, or many of you may know, the state flower are Black-Eyed Susans. So this sort of is the representation of Kent County. I have the Liberian flag here because that is where Garnett passed away in 1882. And what's especially significant about that is that he, in the last few months of his life, was actually the American ambassador to Liberia. And he was given a very honorable and state sanctioned and presented funeral by the Liberian government when he passed away. And lastly, what I want to talk about with Garnett is I think it's absolutely important for us to acknowledge that this great American came from here. But at the same time, when we acknowledge and celebrate Garnett, we have to remember that he left here when he was 9 years old. He had to leave when he was 9 years old because of the conditions of Kent County, and that African Americans couldn't thrive here for the most part. And he had to move up north his family had to move up north to sort of make better lives for themselves as best they could in the United States in the early 19th century. And that's one thing that I think, as much as we celebrate him, we also have to remember what it took for him to exist in the United States. So now I'll hand it back over to Yvette, and I will see you guys later and talk about some more of the artwork in the show.
Thank you very much, Jason. Introducing our next performer, Ifediba Diana Moneke, class of 2023, is a first generation student at Washington College, majoring in international relations and minoring in public policy. She is also a Starr Center intern working on the Chesapeake Heartland Project. She lives by two self-created mottos. The P in pink stands for power, and the sky is not my limit, it is my starting line. Ifediba Diana Moneke.
You may write me down in history with your bitter, twisted lies. You may trod me like the very dirt that you walk on, but still like dust, I'll rise. Does my sassiness upset you? Does my woman offend you? Does my Nigerian, Italian, American intimidate you? Does my intersectional feminist scare you? Boo. Women are taught to aspire to marriage. Women are taught to aspire to success. So like Lady Rogers, mark my words, I look success in the eye and I said that I use every bone in my body, every blood cell that runs through the course of my veins to tear, tarnish, rip, demolish, banish every single piece of injustice in an injustice justice system. Yes, I have the power to give birth to the next generation. Yes, I also have the power to move a nation. And yes, that power, that very same power, I just took my seat at my CEO position. And so even though we still face the difficulties of today and tomorrow, I still have a dream. A dream deeply rooted in the American dream to let freedom ring. To let freedom ring. Harriet Shepherd rings as she steals her master's carriage. Let freedom ring. Henry Highland Garnett rings as he picks up the gun. Let freedom ring. Isaac Mason rings as he picks up the pen. Let freedom ring. Sumner Hall rings as the vets don the blue. Let freedom ring. Josephine Carr rings as she refuses to leave that ferry. Let freedom ring. Elmer T. Hawken rings as he shouts and insists education for all. Let freedom ring. And when we allow this freedom to ring, when we let it ring from every crank and corner of Chestertown, Maryland, from every doorknob to every pencil of Washington College, from every single seat of justice in Washington, D.C., from every single seat of justice in Washington, D.C., from every single seat of justice in our democracy, from every state and every city, we speed up the day that all of God's children, black women and white women, white men and black men, Jews, Catholics, Muslims, Baptists, Protestants can join together and sing of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Almighty God, we are free at last. So leaving behind the endless nights of terror and fear, Grandma Chestertown, rise into a daybreak that's wondrously clear. Generations of the old and the young tear tackle at the blanket of the unsung. Bringing back the gifts that my ancestors gave. I am the dream and the hope of the slave. So watch me stride. Watch me rise. Watch me make your candlelight dimmer, Simon Wilmer. Mothers, fathers, Mother Kent County, they rise. Children of Kent County, children of Washington College, Chesapeake Heartlands children, we rise. So trap me in a jail cell, lock me in a cage, hands up, don't shoot. So go ahead. Write me down in history with those guys. And trod me like the very dirt that you walk on. But still, like dust, I'll rise. Thank you.
Thank you, Ifediba. Our next performer is Kentavius Jones. Has been around music his whole life and grew up going to Union Baptist Church in Easton. He formed his first band and began writing songs while attending Washington College. Tonight he offers a performance of Hand on the Plow and Swing Low, Sweet Chariot from his most recent project, The Spiritual Initiative. Kentavius Jones was involved with the Starr Center as an undergrad almost 20 years ago. So we are delighted to have him return for this event.
Hello, my name is Kentavius Jones, and I'm here on behalf of the Maryland Spirituals Initiative. And this song is Hand on the Plow.
Hold on.
This next piece is called Swing Low, Sweet Chariot.
Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Well, I looked over the Jordan, tell me, what did I see? Coming for to carry me home. A band of angels are coming after me. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot. Coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Well, if you get there before I do, coming for to carry me home, tell my friends that I'll be coming too, coming for to carry me home. Swing low, sweet chariot, coming for to carry me home. Swing low,
Thank you, Kentavius. Our next performer this evening is Tevi Ann Swinson. Tevi Ann Swinson is a local performing artist. She established the local music collective Small Town Big Artists in 2018. Small Town Big Artists is an idea inspired by conversations with her late mother and Washington College alum, Dora. Tevi Ann dedicates tonight's performance of her original poem, Their Story, Her and History, to her mother's strength.
Their story, her story, history. Their story is their story to tell. Only they know their story so well. They are no longer here with us, so their story we will tell. But yet again, only they know their stories so well. Some are buried in the sea by the depths and waters that be. Others drowned here on earth, covered by mounds of dust and dirt. And some still grace us with their presence, with stories of triumph and heartache to bear. Many stories were covered, smothered, so that we will never ever hear. And sometimes it seems as if everyone's moved on without a care. Completely and totally unaware. But to be here, you must have recognized us have been there. Like the ozone, it needs all of its many layers. The monstrous prayers, the misconceptions and betrayals, the undying tenacity of souls unwilling to fail, to prevail, to die. And even if one did, it would create another life to survive. Creating systems, traditions, and mental ammunition. Maintaining and creating while simultaneously attaining a level of free that they may never see. Grasping at straws, living life on pause, fear and revere for the value of oneself, all that they were and will be. The unwillingness to melt into an unknown abyss, to always and forever remain in her stories and his stories, in our history. I cannot and will not speak on things that I did not see, but we must always commend, acknowledge the happenings that will always be, these happenings that make up her story, his story, our history. Thank you.
Well, that was wonderful. Hopefully you guys can see me this time. I heard that some of you couldn't see me on the last piece I talked about, the Garnett piece. I hope you could hear me. If you heard me, that's great. And if you wanna see great images of that artwork, please again visit the Chesapeake Heartland website where you can see all the artwork that is in this show. So the next piece I'm gonna talk about is a piece that it's a different aspect of the artwork that I do, where I recreate historical documents. Sometimes when I create these documents, I take real text, but create new formats and make them look like they're from the 19th century or at any other time period. But this one I actually found this piece when I was a visiting artist at Temple University, and I was in the Charles Blockson African-American archive at Temple University, and they had a copy of the first edition of William Still's Underground Railroad. So when I found this, I was like, I don't need to recreate anything, I don't have to redesign anything, I just need to recreate this piece exactly how it is. So here is the cover page, and I know it's not, you can't see it that great through a Zoom video, but again, please visit the Chesapeake Heartland website and you can see this artwork and see the close details of what I'm about to talk about. So this is the cover page of William Still's Underground Railroad. Now, his book was essentially just an archive or an account of all the people who came through his home and his business in Philadelphia. William Still's was an Underground Railroad conductor and a strong abolitionist in Philadelphia. So when people would come to him, he would record their stories as they told him. Now, when I was going through this book, I was like, let me see if I can find anything on the Eastern Shore. And what I found was, as you heard in Diana's beautiful poem earlier, the story of Harriet Shepherd. Now, Harriet Shepherd escaped from Chestertown with her children and other enslaved African-Americans and eventually made it to William Still's in Philadelphia. What's extra special about the account of her story is that it comes with an illustration. There's this beautiful illustration of her on the carriage with her family and with other enslaved people who escaped. So this is an incredibly important historical document, the book, The Underground Railroad. And it's very special for us in Kent County and in Chestertown that part of our history is impressively shown through a specific illustration about Harriet Shepherd's story. So I was really excited to create this artwork and it's one of my favorite pieces in the show. So I'll see you guys in a little bit with one last overview of the artwork that I did for this project.
Thank you very much, Jason. Our next performer is Elena Deanda-Camacho, is an associate professor of Spanish at Washington College and director of the Black Studies program. The poem she will read tonight is titled The Colors of the U.S. or Chromopolis. It is a piece of her English written work focused on U.S. politics.
Thank you, Yvette, and thank you everyone, and thank you Tara and Jason for sharing their work. So I start. Chromopolis or How to Be a BIPOC in the USA. Blue is the color of a pure sky. No, wait. Blue is Democrat. Wait, no. Blue is a color that matters. Blue has declared war to black. In the back of a truck, a blue stripe speaks of a secret society made of individuals who have seen too much Law and Order, too many Terminators, Homelands, and reruns of Robocop. Blue believes that my safety depends on a shooting range. Red is the color of my blood. Red appears monthly in my clothes. Red used to scare me. Then at some point it became just a lady that asks for her payment every month. Red clears my skin. Red brings me renewal and a clear understanding of cycles. But red is now MAGA. Red is Republican too. Red sometimes spits in my brown face and looks at me with the side of its eye. Red and blue are in the flag, but they are not the clear sky of the blood of the brave. I never know who's red or blue by looking at the political signs of my neighbor's lawns. White on its side is the color of peace. White is the snow. White is my mom. But white has been stolen by a supremacist whose skin color honestly balances between transparent, yellow, and pink. White is supreme, and I feel robbed because the backs of my hands and my feet are white, my teeth and eyes are white, and I don't believe even remotely that neither my palms nor my teeth feel superior to any other body part. Black is my hidden spot. Black is the deepest root. Black is bad, they say. Black is legacy. Black is not an ethnic group. Black is not a race. Black is just a color. Black is elegant. And yet, black in the US is the other half, the half that bleeds, the half historically separated by the chasm of a capitalism that oscillates between greatness and greediness, between adventure and genocide. Black is wrong, they say. There is a black market, black sheep, darkest thoughts, a dark side of the moon, a dark side of the force. And yet, black is the color of my Nana, and dark are her beautiful wrinkled paper thin hands. Green is the color of nature. Baby green are the trees that spring in mid-April. Green is moss, and I'm certain that green is the smell of the soil after the rain. But here, now, green is the hallucination of red socialists who want to take away our gray coals and our gray fumes and install luminescent panels. Green was supposed to be the color of money, but here now, greens are those who want to plant trees instead of building working plants, who wants to destroy the blue and the other red and the whites for a green that is consistently sold as a bad deal. But green is my banana plant and the lemons that I harvested last year. Green comforts me in the winter cold and comforts the ones I love. Me, I'm copper, brown, burnt sienna, butterscotch, amber, often yellow. Green if I ate breakfast too late. Pink if I feel giddy. My son struggles to find the right color for his portraits. Are we brown, Mom? He asks. Are we beige? He wonders. No, Mom, we are tan. And I believe him. In my hometown, I am a morena. I reminisce medieval Moors in blood-obsessed Spain. Morenica soy, Moorish, Spanish, and Jewish. You can hyphenate me and say that I'm half Spanish, half Indian, half Afro, but the math fails. I'm not halves, I'm whole. I'm whole Spanish and I verse in the tongue of Cervantes. I'm whole Afro and I know rhythm and root. I'm whole Zapotec and I lashed out my fork tongue. I'm all that and all the others who are not region or color tied. My whole awesomeness cannot be divided in halves. Here, I'm just a Mexican. In Europe, exotic. In the US, narcotic. Now, I'm a Mexican American because I wield a blue that opens borders, and I have no more greens that put me in a gray spaces. And yet, every day I hear BIPOC, and I announce BIPOC, and I'm called BIPOC, and I wonder what color they want me to ink. Thank you.
Thank you, Elena. Karen Somerville joins us once again with another performance, I Wish I Knew How It Would Feel to Be Free by Nina Simone.
What in
enemies to be me. Then you see and agree that every man should be free. I wish I could give all the longing to give. I wish I could live like I'm longing to live. I wish I could do all the things that I can do. Though I'm way overdue, I'd be starting.
Once again, absolutely wonderful. That was so great. So the last piece, group of artwork that I'm going to talk to you guys about is these three portraits of the first African-American graduates from Washington College. So this will be the kind of the Washington College piece in the among the stuff I'm going to talk about tonight. Now, who we have here is Thomas Morris, Patricia Godbolt, and Shirley Dale Patterson. Now, these Thomas Morris, who is the first graduate, graduated in 1962. Now, that was only 59 years ago now, but which is not that long ago, but what's really important to sort of consider is that that Washington College, as we all know, was the first American college, meaning it was established after the American Revolution. The college was established in 1782, meaning it took 180 years for Washington College to graduate an African-American student. So Thomas graduated in 1962, went on to join the Peace Corps. He came back, got his graduate degrees, and then went on to teach mathematics throughout Baltimore for a long career. And then this year, they renamed one of the college's resident halls after Morris. So the Thomas Morris Hall is now over on campus. Patricia Godbolt made history even before she came to Washington College to become the first African-American woman to be a graduate at Washington College. In 1960, she was the first African-American to graduate from the integrated Virginia public school system. And she's from Norfolk, and after she finished at Washington College, she went back to Norfolk, finished her graduate degree, and then taught in the Norfolk public schools for, I believe, over 40 years. And then lastly, you can see down there is Shirley Dale Patterson. After she graduated from Washington College, she became a college professor and a scientist. But what's what other sort of other significant things that she did related to Washington College was she was in the 1980s became the first African American to be on the board of visitors and governors at Washington College. So these three graduates all contributed so much to Washington College while also going on and bettering their communities here in the United States and even abroad. So it was really an honor to be able to, not only to be able to create these artworks, but also to interact with these great people's families. I got permission from Thomas Morris's late wife to do this piece, which was great to talk to her and her children. And then I got permission from Patricia Godbolt and Shirley Dale Patterson's children, and I had great conversations with them. So this triptych was one of my favorite pieces to do in this project. So I'll hand it back over to Yvette and we'll finish out this evening. Thanks again, everybody.
Thank you, Jason. Our next performer this evening is Robert Earl Price. Robert Earl Price is an award-winning, internationally acclaimed screenwriter, playwright, and poet. He is the author of 3 screenplays, 5 books of poetry, and 12 plays produced in the US and abroad. This evening, he shares 3 original works of poetry.
Good evening. I'd like to share 3 poems of remembrance and maybe a short 4th one. I have the privilege of being able to read more than one poem this evening. I'd like to thank Jason for this marvelous exhibition, reminder, historical landmark. I'd like to thank Earl Lee and all the people at Chesapeake Heartland. I'd like to thank everyone who performed before me, and I'll read these poems of remembrance. The first is entitled A Poem of Remembrance, and it's for Maryland's Emancipation Day, November 1, 1864. It's a reminder that the border states were not, slaves in the border states were not set free at the same time of Lincoln's proclamation. And over a year later, the slaves in Maryland, including Kent County, were finally declared emancipated. Emancipation wasn't as big a deal as we make it sound today, though a great deal. A poem of remembrance. We look back to that day when we were unshackled and turned out to stagger in unforgiving cities. Neither slave nor citizen, 6 generations of people without stop and frisk passes, our lives sifted like sand through spread fingers. Today, we sing in velvet shackles, our murders sanctioned by drug and gang related excuses for legalizing genocide, blaming the dead children for their mangled bodies littering Martin Luther King Boulevard with 400 years of trash. This is not the bated breath of understanding. This is the red-lined privilege that refuses to spare or share this earth. This is not the brotherhood promised. This is not the world we sought. This is the broad blue beyond. We are the tattered remnants of a myth, afloat in a sea of mugshots, sailors in quest of the blind woman, clutching the scale of righteousness. Our hiptivity, a rhythmic proclivity for avoiding chokehold, taser, baton to the head, or 6 rounds to the chest. Our acidic tears, etching iron memorials, Jamestown, Tulsa, East St. Louis, Ferguson, where shall we celebrate next? Hidey-ho, doo-wop, hip-hop, vocalizing, sensationalizing the headlines, repackaging our past as creative nonfiction, redacting history with fuzzy science. Our raised voices shown in replay, our sacred praise songs drained of meaning and sold. Weary of white papers and leery of commissions charged with studying the obvious, wary of feigned pretense by those who didn't see a thing, didn't hear a thing, didn't say a thing, never knew, never suspected that our burdened backs underpin the world. Slowly we rise, dark matter from the bottom of a deep blue beyond. We are coated whispers of torn rigging, the remnants of a myth, caramel doubloons scorching the bottom of the melting pot. And the salty blue beyond. This is the griot's tale. It does not claim the whole truth, just some of it. And on my ancestors' graves, I swear to you that most of this is true. I like to write poems of celebration. And in June of 2014, after falling into disrepair, Sumner Hall was reopened through the effort of the Chestertown King County community. And this is a poem of celebration. It's called Celebrating Juneteenth at Sumner Hall. We are dancing in the swirling light of an old communal circle. Our clasped hands are a link between back then and someday. Our presence here, testament to this cathedral of memory. We are the children of their children's children, progeny of blood and lash, a testament to solidarity, a monument to courage. This hall is an act of collective will. It embraces passive ingenuity conjured in a mist of secrets. Our elders unraveled the coffin of lynch laws, wearing the skin of determination. We rejoice because those elders, those wisdom trees, are rooted in an ancient tradition. Once again, we inhabit the fleeting scent. Today is homecoming and uprising. We stand on the rock where the strong folks stood. We praise the freedom fighters, praise the kinsmen of justice and the persistent peace seekers. Oh, we are here to salute the stalwarts, the solemn shapers who first danced and danced and danced, proud spirited grace swirling in the army hall, certain that this day would come. Now we rise, a fresh wave breaking over a new day. We stand here on the shoulders of those purposeful people. We walk in their footsteps. We stand in the long shadow of proud folks, people who would not wallow in the muck and mire of ash and fear. They created this neutral site, this village square, this precious palace, a university of their own, a magical music box producing a soundtrack for the long trek toward justice, voting rights measured by the square foot. Human reverence spread like flowers over the graves of all of the fallen. We re-inhabit this place of promise. We come here in praise of men and women that marched, voted, and danced with fierce determination. We return with respectful praise for the sepia shadows and lingering memories swirling in the army hall, dancing in the dappled light between dream and memory. That way, sorrow, this way, home. Fraternal spirits bobbing and weaving in the flickering rays of remembrance. Let today become a verse and a song of exaltation, a praise song for the colored vets, a praise song for the Benevolent Women's League, and a praise song for the keepers of the vision. Well, I had another one if I can find it. Well, I'll close with a short one. It's called My Tongue is a Golden Sardine. This recently, Lawrence Ferlinghetti died at 101. He's one of the last of the beatniks. And I've been reading a lot of his obituaries, and rarely mentioned among them is a man that co-founded City Lights with him by the name of Bob Kaufman. He's one of the few African-American beatniks who rose to any kind of power, fame, recognition in San Francisco. He was a San Francisco Denzin and Buddhist who took long periods of silence. When JFK was murdered, Bob Kaufman, the Black beatnik, remained silent for 12 years, did not speak to anyone. Now, there are those who say that he would ask to bum a cigarette or silently communicate with some of his old friends, but rarely spoke for 12 years. So this is called My Tongue is a Golden Sardine. I am the landless end, the voiceless void, the fears numbered and uncoiled, the crawling king snake's daddy. My forked tongue forks two times. I hiss and towers tumble like cascading crescendos and chord-changing breakdowns. I am the ashy black blue man improvising nasty licks. I am the bottomless, endless, allness nestled in the reptilian corner of myself. Prayer will not cool us, rage will not warm us, misbegotten brawlers silent as Buddhist figurines. Clever counterpunches cringing at the bell. I am the fire-breathing serpent sent to send you your sins away. The last beatnik breathing on a smoldering ember beneath the glow of your better light. My tongue swallows the night. At sunrise, I will spit this tongue, a golden sardine into my hand. I will kiss it longingly and hurl it into the surf. Dumb again. Speaker of no language spoken in this land. Good evening.
Thank you for that wonderful poem. Our last performer this evening is Reverend May Etta Moore. Reverend May Etta Moore has been a beloved minister on the Eastern Shore for 35 years. She is originally from Long Island, New York, and was called to the ministry at age 15. Now at age 95, she still preaches at visiting churches and teaches Spanish to senior citizens. We conclude this evening's performance with an excerpt from an interview with Reverend Moore conducted by Chesapeake Heartland. In this short excerpt, Reverend Moore shares her wisdom and sings to us in Spanish. You can access this interview in its entirety on the Chesapeake Heartland website.
So I just was thinking of this little chorus. Él está aquí tú no lo le ve. Él está aquí, tú no le ve. You're referring to the presence of God. And so you're saying, he's here. You don't see him, but he's here. Yes, so you pray for me and I pray for you and let's pray for everybody. Okay. Él está aquí, tú no le ve. Él está aquí, tú no le ve. Orad por mí, oro por ti, orad por todos al Señor. And then three hand claps. Sing it again. Él está aquí. And you can go on, but if they get the idea, you know, let's pray for everybody. Yes, all inclusive.
Ladies and gentlemen, that concludes our evening performances. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank you, the audience, and all our performers, the Starr Center, Chesapeake Heartland, and Cole Gallery. I now turn it over to Tara.
Wow. What an incredible, incredible program. I'd like to just quickly say apologies for any technical difficulties you might have experienced. If you missed anything, this event will be screening on Facebook on the Starr Center's page, and it will be added to the Chesapeake Heartland website along with previous community conversations. I'd like to thank Yvette Hynson for being MC tonight, and all the performers for sharing your powerful, unique voices. Just such amazing, amazing voices. I'd like to thank the audience for tuning in and offering your support to this all-star cast. And I'd like to extend a personal thank you to Jason Patterson and Early Johnson, Adam Goodhart, Patrick Nugent, the Chesapeake Heartland and Starr Center teams at large for their unwavering support. And finally, a sincere thank you to Washington College Campus Events, Mike Covina and Gina Ralston in particular for their support of this event tonight. Early.
Thank you. Thank you to everyone. This was such a wonderful, wonderful program. I enjoyed every minute of it. Thank you so much for, this is the beginning of the second program, Thursdays with the Starr. Every Thursday, there will be a program that the Starr Center will sponsor. So please stay tuned for all the activities. Please continue to look on the Starr Center's website and you will be brought up to date with the programs that we are having. Next Thursday, we have Neil Gabler. He will introduce his new book, Edward Kennedy's Rise. That will be at 5 o'clock next Thursday. Please visit the Starr Center's website or Facebook page to get more information on upcoming events. And also continue to follow Chesapeake Heartland. We have many activities that are being planned throughout the year. We sort of got a slow start because of COVID, but we've been working very hard this entire year. And so we're ready to come forward and share many, many activities with the community. Thank you so much, everyone, for joining us tonight. And we look forward to seeing you next Thursday with the Starr. All right, good night.